Well, hello and welcome to the Photo Brigade Podcast. I'm Robert Caplin. Today, I'm really excited to be with Michael Zagaris. How are you, Michael?
Good. You know, I'm losing my voice, but I'm in great shape.
Well, I mean, there's a reason why you're losing your voice, and that's because you just had an epic gallery exhibit and book launch at the Milk Gallery here in New York City. How was that?
Unbelievable. I mean, you know, I didn't really have any expectations because I try to go into everything just fresh and, you know, like walk through and let it wash over me.
Right.
But it was incredible. It was kind of like, you know, being at a Mad Magazine party where you run into Nikita Khrushchev and Marilyn Monroe and Alfred E. Newman. And
right.
They were
right.
All there.
Right. And the book launch was actually for this new book, Total Excess, which is basically your archives from shooting and touring with some of the biggest rock legends, including, you know, Led Zeppelin, we had The Who, Leonard Skinner, the Rolling Stones. You toured with the Stones. I mean, the list goes on and on and on, and we're going to go through some photos and everything, but I'm just excited to, I don't even know where to start, to be honest, with this conversation, because your career spans, you know, so many decades and genres too, because you're not only a music photographer, but for the past 40 plus years, you've been the team photographer for the San Francisco 49ers.
Right.
And for about the same amount of time for the Oakland Athletics.
Correct. Yeah.
So it's been quite a career you've had and continue to have here. So, but before we jump into your photos, I just want to give a quick thanks to Adorama for letting us use their event space to record our podcast today. Thanks to the people that are tuning in on Facebook Live. Hello. Internet world, please hit the like button and follow us and turn on notifications for our future events like this. And then lastly, thank you to Canon and Canon Professional Services. You guys are super cool for doing all that you do in Tenba Bags. So let's get on to your career. Z-Man, that's what everyone calls you too, Z-Man.
Among other things. Those are the things you can repeat.
Oh, right. So before we jump really into your, you know, rock and roll photography and talk about what's going on here in New York, I want to give people sort of a background, a little bit of background on you, because you didn't start, before your career, you were trying to get in the world of politics, right? You were in law school.
Right.
Where'd you go to law school?
Santa Clara.
And so you grew up in California.
Born in Chicago, grew up in the Valley.
Okay.
Places like Modesto, Hanford, Stockton, Reading. Went to prep school in San Jose, Jesuit prep school. Went to school back east, Washington, D.C.
Uh-huh.
Came back for California for law school. But, you know, I knew almost immediately that wasn't for me.
Uh-huh.
You know, I was more into... My idea of what the law was, you know, arriving at justice.
Right.
And I saw it was more about a nuanced, you know, way of a profession to make money. And half the people I was in law school with wanted to do that. Or they were in love with the law.
Uh-huh.
And I always saw the law as something that you use the way an artist uses paint to arrive at justice.
Uh-huh.
And in that world then and now, you often get as much justice as you can afford.
Yeah, yeah. And then you had political ambitions.
Right.
And you were on Bobby Kennedy's campaign staff. Is that correct?
I worked for him because in Washington, D.C., I worked for Pierre Salinger. He was JFK's press secretary. And after JFK was assassinated, at a certain point, he was appointed senator to California after Claire Engel died. So I worked with him. Then he was defeated by George Murphy.
Uh-huh.
Went to Paris, came back. We were on the phone one day, and he said, "Hey, how'd you like to work on the Hill?" And I said, "You know, I'm carrying 17 and a half units. I'm playing ball. I don't have a lot of time, but, you know, it's a part-time job, sure."
And so you were playing ball?
Football.
You were playing football?
Right.
Oh, wow.
Right.
Incredible. Like, professionally?
Well, college.
College, yeah, okay,
college.
Got it.
But that was, you know, my plan at that point in time, and people laugh now. Uh-huh. But, I thought, okay, I'm going to I'm going to play college, and I'll play 5 or 6 or 7 years in the NFL. I'll have a beautiful wife. Then I'll run for Congress. Then I'll run for the Senate. Then I'll be president.
Hey.
And I was a Sino-Soviet major because I thought, this way, when I become president, I'll negotiate my own treaties with the Russians and the Chinese. You tell that now to people, and they like, oh, dude, that's hilarious. But that was part of the time. You know who else was very similar? Iggy Pop, James Osterberg. And you look at Iggy now, and you're like, what? Are you kidding? But no, that's...
That's incredible. And so you were actually right beside or right nearby.
Behind. We had come off the stage, and it was like low ceiling, and it was like crazy. It was so hot. I mean, it's literally... You're soaking wet. And I didn't know where we were going. Somebody said we were going upstairs. There were going to be parties in the suites. Somebody else said there were buses outside. We're going to another hotel. And was so I'm just following people. And as we started back, is what turned out going back into the kitchen, it sounded like somebody let out a string of firecrackers. And I remember Bill Eppridge was right behind me.
Right.
And kind of like ran by me and knocked me against the door. And he yelled 9mm. And I thought, well, that's like a fisheye lens. I didn't even equate that with guns. And that night, that was, you know, Bobby died the next day. I had to fly back to San Francisco and then go to Santa Clara for law final. I remember it was contracts.
Mm-hmm.
And they passed out the test. And I remember I took my wallet out and I had a couple of those square baseball player heads that Topps had in, mm-hmm. wax. So I had a Juan Marichal. I put it on the blue book, transferred it with a quarter, put a little balloon where Juan's mouth was, and wrote, Mike, this is bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I filled, I think, 7 or 8 blue books with how America was fucked and killed its leaders. And that was the end of law school.
That was the end.
Which was fine with me. And my parents freaked, you know, like, God, are you kidding? What are you going to do? And at that point, I only knew what I didn't want to do. And I remember I started experimenting with LSD because I had read Huxley's book. And James Hersey had a book came out that called, I think it was called, Don't Look Now, Don't Look Back.
Uh-huh.
And I knew the Beatles had dropped. And I wasn't dropping acid to escape or get high or, you know, run away. I was like searching for truth. Searching for self.
Mm-hmm.
And that first trip, it was like the veil was pulled back. I learned more than I learned in prep school, college, law school, working
wow.
for the Kennedys, and it was like an awakening.
Wow. So that was the big transition, and then you started getting into photography at that point. Yeah.
Well, you know, I'd always taken pictures from the time I was a kid.
Uh-huh.
My brother and I made our own little football cards, and you know, we took pictures everywhere we went, but never with the idea that I would do this as a profession or making a living.
Mm-hmm.
I started hanging out at the Fillmore, and the music scene was unbelievable, and it was just starting to take off both in this country and globally. The bands that really resonated with me were a lot of the English bands. I mean, the Beatles and the Stones were already big, but people like Led Zeppelin, Fleetwood Mac, and they were like largely a blues band 10 years after, they were all coming in, reworking American blues, a lot of which we'd never heard,
mm-hmm.
unless you were in the Deep South, it wasn't played on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
And so introducing us to this whole different blues culture, and their style, unlike most American bands, they were much more flamboyant and theatrical.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started working on a book how they were doing this and greatly influencing our culture and at the same time being influenced by it. In those days, all you had to do if you were doing what I was doing, I used to have a couple joints in my pocket. I'd go backstage. I'd have a tape recorder. I'd have my camera with me basically to document, like you'd have a camera if you're going to Paris or
sure.
taking pictures. And over a year and a half, I'm accumulating, you know, all this knowledge. And Cream had broken up. Eric Clapton came back to the Bay Area. He was with Delaney and Bonnie at the time,
mm-hmm.
staying at the South Salido Inn. Go up to Eric's room, and he loved the South Salido Inn because no phones in the room, no TV.
Uh-huh.
You're like sequestered.
Uh-huh.
So I had a little hash pipe. We're smoking hash. He's going through the transcripts of the interview we had done. I'm marking proof sheets, and at one point he goes, what you've got there? And I said, it's proof sheets and everything. He says, well, can I have a look? And I said, yeah, here. So I remember I gave him a couple proof sheets and the loop, and he's going, yeah, these are great. And I said, you know, if you put the loop actually on the proof sheet and your eye on it, you can actually see these. He goes, yeah, no, right. And so he starts looking. He goes, oh, man, these are fucking great. He says, can we use these? And I said, sure, for what? He says, songbooks, albums. He says, look, man, we'll pay you. And I said, yeah, cool, man. He says, the writing's all right, but you should be, like, doing this for a book. And I said...
So Eric Clapton was sort of like the person who pushed you into to getting to do this more and getting paid to do this type
yeah.
of work.
Well, I mean, that's all, when you say paid, that's what I thought too. I've been doing this for 40 some years, and I tell people I feel like I've never had to work a day in my life because I love
right.
what I do. I have a passion for it. And when I look at my bank account, I feel like I've never worked
oh,
a day
no.
in my life because
oh, no.
I have no money.
Well, I mean, that's one of the... So you consider Eric Clapton, you know, to be one of your good friends. Yeah?
Or? You know what? I hardly ever see him now. It was one of those things where you hook up.
And like, and Peter Frampton is...
Well, Peter I see more than anyone because what I ended up doing, I was telling Peter that at that point in time, he was in a group called Humble Pie.
Uh-huh.
And they'd come to San Francisco. I'd show him and his wife, Mary, around. And Peter said, you know, you got to come to London. And I said, well, London. He says, look, I've got a place in St. John's Wood. If you like, you can, you know, spend some time with me, you know, take pictures. So I was married at the time, went to London. I had another friend. We stayed with him for a while. Then I'd stay with Peter. Peter was on the road a lot,
mm-hmm.
you know, because Humble Pie was at that point in time in their career. They were on the road 10.5 months out of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Peter's wife, Mary, very good friend of mine now, she was a model at the time. Twiggy was her best friend. We'd go around and to parties and things. I met people I'd never meet, even if I lived in England.
Yeah.
And so I was in the right place at the right time, and everything kind of just fell together.
That's amazing. So I'm going to start going through some of your photos, and you can feel free to stop, and we can talk about these. But I, you know, thanks to you know, Brad Mangin for helping me put these together last night. This is sort of a last minute podcast that we threw together because you had this, like I said, gallery opening at Milk Studio, which people can go see still here in New York until I think December 18th.
And Milk was, you know, I'll say this about Milk. There are a number of other galleries I could have been in at the time, and you know, very good ones. But Milk was both large, and it wasn't just music, and it had this great eclectic group of people that came in.
Yeah,
a lot of them young.
Yeah,
and it was they're vibrant. It's fashion, it's fine art, it's music, and it just had a great feel. It was just like
right.
you know, you walk in a place and you're going,
yeah,
wow.
I was just there. I just went there. Just stopped there about 30 minutes ago to check it out and pick up your book. So, and everyone can pick up your book, by the way, online. We'll put all the information down below.
Sure.
So let's jump into some of your photos here. We're gonna start off. Tell me about a little bit about this day, because this is. I mean, we've got more photos from this day also later in the slideshow. But
sure.
This is a pretty epic experience for you. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that was. You know, they actually the Who added this show on. They were actually done with their American tour. Had gone back to London, but Bill Graham used to put on things called Day on the Green.
Uh huh.
And they were outdoor shows at the Oakland Coliseum. They're usually anywhere from 40 to 60,000 people would show up, kind of like a mini Woodstock.
Yeah.
And it was an all-day event. The Who and the Grateful Dead.
Amazing.
Did an epic two-day performance together.
Now, was it that the Grateful Dead opened for them?
Yeah.
That's crazy to me, like,
yeah.
just to think.
Well, you know, too, at that point in time, they were both giants in the field.
Yeah.
And I won't say there was no egos, but no egos like you see now.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, you can open, I can open.
Yeah.
And it almost didn't matter.
Right.
It wasn't like that.
Right, right. It was a different vibe. And I'm just going to start off with a few, you know, random shots from your career. This is, you know, amazing. And this one was actually colored after the fact, yeah?
That's, you know, that's a hand tint. Christian Sundbaum, who, love of my life, my muse, my lover, mother of our child. She was a model, an artist, and she started hand tinting things. Uh-huh. Just, you know, like to have something to do. So she did a number of things for me, a cover of a Dylan book. She did some things for Rolling Stone magazine. And we tinted these too. This was the second to the last shoot Leonard Skinner ever did as Leonard Skinner.
Yeah. Because
we did this the day before New Year's in 1976. And in October of 77, they were killed in a, not everyone,
right,
but half of the band was killed in a plane crash.
Incredible, incredible. And there's some more pictures of Robbie coming up here. You know, the late David Bowie, who, you know, is just an epic personality, performer. Everyone loves David Bowie. How much did you shoot Bowie? I mean, was it, was he a regular?
No, yeah. I mean, that show was the only time I ever shot David.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know, he'd come through maybe once every 2 years. The great thing about him, you know, first of all, he and Peter Frampton grew up a mile apart in Kent, went to school together. Peter, David, and I can't remember the other kid's name. They always hung together. They were best friends. Peter's dad taught them music. You know, he was a teacher at the school, taught music and PE. And so those guys were always together. And David was always reinventing himself.
Oh, yeah.
Both, I mean, in terms of music and style. I mean, he was amazing to shoot.
And so his, was it a different vibe when going to a concert of his versus the other shows that you experienced, just the kind of performance he put on?
Well, it was. And the great thing, a lot of the bands I shot, most of the bands I shot that are in the book, it wasn't about, oh, I've got this job. I would shoot bands that I really connected with and related to, and music was part of it. But it was as much lifestyle, fashion, and a lot of the bands, they really emulated and exuded their sound and their lifestyle and what they were. And the fan base was similar.
Yeah.
So it was like a whole sociologic event as well as just going to a concert.
Oh, and Patti Smith in the bathroom. This is a fun story.
Well, we had... I was shooting this for After Dark, and Patti was just starting to take off at the time. People knew her in New York, but she didn't really have a national following. She was very accessible. We're just taking pictures backstage in the dressing room. Very little direction. She was just moving around, trying hats on and off, scarves. And finally, they're getting ready to go on, and she said, well, do you think you've got all you need? And I said, yeah, you know, we've got some great stuff. They were looking for something like, I think they really want some kind of a portrait. She goes, portrait? She walked out the door, and there's just a little hallway, and stepped across into the bathroom, and she goes, how about this for a portrait? And I said, perfect, perfect.
That's great. That's great. I actually photographed her for, I think, the New York Times when she was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Sure.
Just the actual induction ceremony or whatever on stage. It's amazing to see it back in the heyday here. And so one of the things is you're constantly backstage with the bands. You know, you're not nowadays, you know, I've shot a lot of bands for publications and so on, but it's usually the first three songs in the pit. But you, maybe it was also because it was a different era as well, but you were able to really get your way backstage. And, you know, I know that you have these stories of sort of like just giving different stories and just making it back there.
Right.
Can you give me a little bit of background on how you got backstage with all of these? Or,
well, you know, when I started out, you couldn't just walk backstage. You had to have some kind of a little hustle, but say the right thing and you're back. And there was not a problem. There wasn't the labyrinth of PR people, record company people,
right?
The security. I mean, it was all kind of like seeing a band in a club. The reason I started doing this anyway, it was like being in the Beatles or being in the Clash. And to me at the time, it wasn't like, I'm a photojournalist, I want to capture this scene. It's no, I wanted to be in the fucking band.
Yeah.
And I don't play guitar, I don't play drums. I'll have a camera. And often it would be you, the band, a couple of their friends or hangers-on, their connection. And I wanted to have the feel that not only am I in the band, but I wanted photographically, I wanted to shoot them from the inside out, where the people that are seeing the pictures feel like they're in the band.
Mm-hmm.
And just shooting somebody on stage, at a certain point, it doesn't matter whether it's Frank Sinatra or The Clash or the Dead Kennedys. It's people in front of a microphone with colored lights. And at a certain point, it gets boring. Sports is the same way. If you're just shooting action, you see that on TV. You see it. And I think you want to take people behind the scenes. You want to show them something they rarely ever see and give them the feeling that they're part. They're really part of this.
One of the amazing things that I read about you and have heard about is that you are kind of like a method actor in photography. So you become part of the band.
Right.
In terms of experiencing basically everything they experience, from the drugs to just everything.
Yeah.
And this particular photo is not that. You ran in to Iggy Pop at the airport.
Exactly.
And this is just a rant. And this photo is the end of a roll.
Right.
Yep. What a perfect shot.
Well, you know what? And a lot of these, it's not something that's planned. It's kind of like I've lived my life. It's just stream of consciousness.
Right.
And you're trying to capture moments, often moments that you hardly realize are there and almost until after the fact.
Right.
You know, going back to Bobby, the night he was assassinated, that shot that Bill got of the kid cradling Bobby after that was Bill's last roll of film.
Oh, wow.
Getting toward the end of the roll. And he had, you know, he basically walked into the scene as it was unfolding and it happened and had the good fortune to still have film in the camera.
Yeah.
And get all that. And a number of times this has happened to me.
I've met Bill a couple of times at a workshop, and he gave a presentation about that night, obviously. Mm-hmm. And one obviously, you know, the story is similar in everything you said, but he had one of his print made, and he was talking about how he had a house fire. Do you know about this?
Yeah.
And the picture, this famous picture of his, was behind the couch or something
Yeah, right behind the couch, and that was one, everything burned to the ground, and that was one of the few
things.
The
only thing that survived was this photo, and it was charred around Bobby.
Yeah.
And it was just like unbelievable, that image. So anyway, speaking of the late great Bill Epridge, and so going back to we have Lou Reed here, you know, in the drug culture, and I don't know if he's legitimately shooting up here or
you know what, this is gonna sound crazy, I don't know either. I was on assignment for Cream magazine, and halfway through the show, he got the microphone cord out, you know, he's got the works, and I'm shooting, and I kept shooting, and I remember Bill Graham's stage manager, Jerry Pompili, was like behind the amps with me. When Lou was done, took the needle out, threw the needle
in
everything, the works, into the crowd, and they fought for it like it was a chin strap or a wristband that a player had thrown.
Oh my gosh.
And I remember some people from the Cockettes were in the front,
uh-huh,
you know, beating the stage with a studded leather belt, and Lou was actually the more staid person in the front of the audience. And I turned to Jerry Pompili, because when Bill Graham would have an act he really liked at either the beginning or the end, he'd say, "Once again, please, a permanent member of the Fillmore family, Mr. Lou Reed." So I turned to Jerry and I said, "Permanent member of the Fillmore family?" And Jerry turned to me and he goes, "Michael, these people are sick. They're sick."
Incredible, incredible. So how embedded were you with Lou Reed? Was it just a show or?
It was just a two-day period. This picture, which is the cover of my book, we took the day after the show at Winterland, which he either feigned or shot up. Hmm. And I came to the hotel before they were going to leave, and I had proof sheets and everything, and I was showing him the pictures, and I had the whole proof of him shooting up, and I said, he goes, "Wow, this is beautiful. Mm-hmm. I said, hey, don't worry, man, nobody's going to see these. He goes, no, he said, this one here, he said, could you like blow up maybe six, like 11 by 14s? I'd like to give them as gifts. I said, really? And he goes, yeah. And I said, yeah, sure. And then he wrote down a number and a name, and he said, this guy's doing a book on me. He said, you should send this to him. I said, wow. I said, okay. And I said, well, you know, when the Cream story's done, a friend of mine's at Rolling Stone, I said, they're going to do a big review of the album. I said, I could send him that too. He said, oh, that'd be cool. Now, that being said, Lou was really enigmatic. He could be moody, and he could just be like almost unapproachable. Mm-hmm. So I can't say Lou was a friend.
Right.
But he, this particular weekend, it was great and it moved well.
Yeah. So I'm going to break from the music for a minute and jump to, this is actually your author bio, right? In this book.
And if you see that man, don't try to apprehend him.
If you see that, yeah. So a little bit of background on this. This is a mugshot of you. You were arrested for what?
I had done a series of pictures for High Times magazine of Dennis Perone's marijuana supermarket.
Uh-huh.
And we did a cover shot. We did the shot you're seeing right now in the living room.
Uh-huh.
I won't say everyone in San Francisco came there, but many people did. I mean, and there were people from City Hall. There were ball players. So I kind of thought, well, this is covered.
Uh-huh.
And after we did this and it made the cover, Dennis said, he says, hey, can I get some pictures?
Uh-huh.
And I said, sure. He says, I'll buy them. I said, let's do a trade.
A trade, yeah, barter, yeah, nice
exactly.
Barter.
And this particular day, I drove up. The door was open. There were people on the street looking in. A car crashed into the side of the house. But the moral of the story is, don't go shopping when you're hungry. I got about halfway up the stairs and something didn't feel right. I looked at the top and I see some guy with a Pendleton, but it looked like a little glitter and it was like a badge.
Uh-huh.
And I said, hey man, you guys look like you're kind of busy. I said, I can come back. And I started to back down the stairs and somebody puts a gun in my back and said, join the party.
Oh gosh.
And so I get to the top of the stairs, there are TV cameras and everything, and somebody goes, Z-Man, what's up? And I said, yeah, I don't know, man. I said, I'm a journalist. And I said, somebody put a gun in my back. The cop says, journalist? He said, do you have an ID? And now I'm like, yeah. So I give him my license, and now I'm feeling good and we're talking, and cop comes back and he goes, Michael Zagaris, 861 Ashbury. I said, yes sir. He said, do you realize you have $890 of parking tickets?
Oh my gosh.
And I went, oh, really? No, I didn't know that. And he said, yeah, do you have the money? And I said, on me? No, but I said, you know, I live right over the hill. How long are you guys going to be here? But, so at that point, I'm arrested and they took me in the room. There were 40 people. One guy in the back goes, see, man, they got you too. And the cops are like, pff. And we ended up, we go to jail. Takes a long time to book, and I had told Kristen, I'm just going to Dennis's, I'll be back in 10 minutes. Well, this is 3 hours later,
right?
And I keep saying, hey, when do I get my phone call? They won't say anything. Next thing I know, we're in the tank, the door slams shut, and now I'm going, hey, what about my phone call? And some old brother comes up to me and says, oh man, what's the matter, man? I said, you know, I've been busted, I haven't even got a phone call. And the guy goes, I've been in here since Tuesday. I ain't got no call. And this other guy comes up and goes, hey, man, what you motherfuckers in here for? And I said, man, I shouldn't even be here, man. I'm a journalist. And Dennis goes, we're in here for dope, man. And the guy goes, well, you got any? And Dennis goes, fucking A. Whips out two joints. And I'm like,
this is in the
jail. And I'm like, what? We're the toast of the jail. Nobody fuck with us. And that was, and then I was, High Times, you know, wrote to the court, so they threw my stuff out.
Incredible. And so you, then I want to try to jump back into the sort of method acting, not acting, but being part of the band. So you like you said, you got involved in psychedelics. You I assume, did drugs with a lot of these different.
Oh yeah, no, it was all. And you know what? Even today, people go, you did drugs? And I look at them and go, you didn't?
You didn't.
Where the fuck were you?
Yeah.
You missed the best part. Yeah, you know what? We were all experimenting. Everybody was young.
Mm-hmm.
This was uncharted ground. I mean, everybody had their own reasons. The psychedelics for me, that was mind expansion. It really was. Mm-hmm. And it was awareness. When I got into cocaine, I knew immediately it wasn't that. I mean, it was the dark side. But it was also part of the experience.
Mm-hmm.
And I really never thought, as I'm sure many people, both in that scene and other scenes, you think this is part of an escape or this is pleasure or whatever it is, I can control this.
Mm-hmm.
And most of us never hurt anyone at all, except maybe ourselves,
mm-hmm.
in doing this. You know, it wasn't like we were investment bankers fucking over the planet. But it was part of that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
Just like in Paris, you know, it was alcohol or when people like Van Gogh, you know, you had laudanum and things like that. It was all part of the artistic both process and mm-hmm. lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? I don't actually regret anything, although I think I was incredibly lucky.
Did you have some close calls with this stuff?
Yeah, I mean, I got to the point where, and you don't realize you have a problem, you know, until the car goes over the cliff.
Mm-hmm.
I ended up in the emergency one night. I'd done too much cocaine. And when I got out, I thanked the doctors, you know, thank you for saving my life. And they said, saved your life? Oh, we didn't save your life. We monitored you. And by the way, you can't do any more cocaine. You're mm-hmm. allergic. I said, allergic? What do you mean? They said, well, you've probably always been allergic, but your body's reached this toxicity level. You're done. And I believed them, but I think a month later, I was at a club and everybody was tweaked out. And I think I'd smoked a joint and had a couple of drinks. I'm kind of falling out. And the guy at the recording table said, hey, man, you look like you could use a one-in-one. And I said, well, I can't do any more blow. And he goes, what do you mean? So I tell him the story, and he goes, hey, man, lays out a line. He said, one line's not going to kill you. And I thought, so I cut that line in half, and I did half of the half in one nostril, half in the other, and I literally went like this, and almost immediately I started getting that like this numbness in my arm. I started getting this pull on the side of my face like you're having a stroke. And I remember I was like, and I turned and grabbed the guy's arm, and he turned to me and goes, ha, pretty good shit, huh? And the next thing I knew, I'm in ICU, tube in my mouth, tube in my nose, with one of the same doctors looking at me like, what an idiot. That was May of 83. I've never even had the desire. And I consider myself lucky. I mean, I just as easily that could have been it.
Wow.
So that was the end of that.
So for a little perspective, in May of 83, I was 3 months old.
Now you're making me feel old. Come on.
It's incredible the life that you had even just before I was existed, you know, and it's, you know, amazing. So incredible stories. Thank you for being candid and sharing that. And
yeah.
I know that you talk about a lot of that stuff in the book and all these incredible stories expanded upon what we're talking about. Jumping back into the photos now, you know, the stones, these contact sheets, which I was just at the exhibit again at Milk Studios, and you have these mm-hmm. contact sheets blown up for Bowie, for the Stones, for a number of different shoots that you had done. You know, you said that when you came on the scene, Stones were already on the scene. Like, it's not like you were getting them in their infancy so much.
No.
You know, and what was the experience like? I don't know if these next couple of photos are from the same shoot or not.
This is like this photo here is 1975.
Mm-hmm.
72 and 75, arguably, they were at their peak, both musically and just as performers, cultural phenomenon. And they really, I think in many ways, epitomized where not just the country or England was, but kind of where the West was.
Mm-hmm.
It was, you know, the nadir of what rock and roll had evolved into, and style, beauty, decadence. And I always thought the Stones and the Beatles from mid to late 60s were kind of yin and yang, the opposite ends of what was going on.
Right.
And like, I think all of us, I think, and the universe, even molecules, everything is held together by yin and yang, positive, negative. And they were an amazing, and actually still are, an amazing force.
Oh, yeah. I've had the good fortune to photograph them in concerts over the past decade myself, and it's amazing. They're still going. I mean,
Mick is like a 22-year-old welterweight boxer. I mean, 2.5 hours with those huge stage, always in motion and singing.
Oh, yeah. He's so animated.
It's amazing.
Yeah. You talk about the Coliseum that you were just talking about with the Grateful Dead and who else was it? The Who and everybody, and being having these all these heavyweights kind of working together at the same time was a pretty amazing experience. And the closest I can say, and I will always remember it, is I probably one of the best experiences of my life. I had the privilege of shooting the 12/12/12 Hurricane Sandy benefit concert here at Madison Square Garden. I did, you know how you can do FaceTime, right, with people on your phone and everything. So my younger sister Shannon is huge. She feels that she grew up in the wrong generation. She's total, you know, into everything that she would love to have been you, essentially. And so I said, text her, said, I'm at this concert, you've got to see this. And I had all access because I was shooting for the Robin Hood Foundation, which was sponsoring this or putting us on. And I did a FaceTime with her, and I just held the thing beside the camera while I'm going around shooting, going through the hallway. And in one room, it's the Rolling Stones, and I point up at it and look in, and there's the Rolling Stones. And then it's, you know, Eric Clapton and just every single one of these bands that were there. I mean, you just dream about those sort of things.
Wow.
That was a really cool experience for me. So I have a feeling I'll never experience anything like that again. I mean, hopefully there's nothing too terrible that needs a benefit concert like that. But anyway, let's move on. So Peter Frampton was, tell me a little bit about this. He's your buddy.
Yeah, and I took this picture the day after Altamont. Peter was in town with Humble Pie, and they were playing the Fillmore, opening up for the Grateful Dead. And so, of course, he wasn't at Altamont. But I picked them up the next day, and I was like totally blown out and destroyed. I mean, Altamont was like, everybody thought it was going to be bigger than Woodstock, and it turned out to be a disaster. And one of the reasons was everybody got stoned and took everything they could get their hands on so they could be higher than Woodstock. And then, you know, with what happened with the Hells Angels and, I mean, everything. So I'm telling Peter and Mary about this. We drove up to Tamalpais. And this is at sunset. This is in December. And it was just a beautiful moment. Peter and Mary together, the wind's blowing softly. The ocean's right below. You can see the ocean there. And I loved the feel of the picture.
Yeah.
And it was kind of the opposite of where I had come from.
Yeah. And you, when you were doing this book and everything, when you obviously look back at all these photos again, was it just like reliving it all again, looking through these photos, or did you actually just like ship these images to an editor?
No. I mean, the editor, it was Dagan James, who designed my book. You know, Dagan used to publish a magazine called Lid Magazine out of New York, and we'd been friends forever, and we'd actually been working first on scanning and compiling all this, and then putting the book together. Dagan was the one that introduced me to my publisher, Tony Norman, Real Art Press in London. And we spent probably 4 months, the last 2 months, almost every day immersed in this project.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, going over again and again. And I was, in some senses, reliving some of the things. Going through some of the proof sheets, you're actually seeing pictures for the first time,
right,
that you had shot. But, you know, when
you didn't
when something's
select,
fresh, you either missed it or it didn't resonate, and now you're looking at it with totally fresh eyes.
Yeah, yeah.
And the, you know what? The great thing about all of this, you're freezing moments in time, and when you go back, it's almost like you can relive it.
I mean, this is an incredibly famous photo. I mean, I've seen this everywhere. I just watched the movie. It must have been on Netflix or something. I just watched the movie on these guys, Van Zandt. Is this the same show, the Oakland Coliseum?
That's at the Oakland Coliseum, and they were on the bill with Peter Frampton.
Okay.
And at that point in time, Frampton was like the biggest band in the world. Frampton Comes Alive was out. But Skynyrd was arguably the best American band. I thought they'd certainly supplanted the Allman Brothers. And nothing against the Allman Brothers.
Right, right.
But they were this incredible three-guitar band, incredible energy. But they were out there. They partied hard, mm-hmm. and they played hard, and they embodied what they sang about, both in terms of the music, the lyrics, and their lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I met them the first time when I was doing The Who in 73. That was the first show of The Who tour in November 73. That was their first professional gig.
Wow.
And The Who's road manager, Peter Rudge, was their manager.
Which is this guy.
No, that's Bill Graham.
Oh. Bill Graham, yes.
And they were kind of scared before they went on.
Uh-huh.
And I thought, Lynyrd Skynyrd, what the hell is this? And I was backstage with The Who and then came on stage to hear them, and it was like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
Who are these guys?
Yeah,
guys are. And then they were great down-home Southern guys.
Mm-hmm.
They were people that at that point in time you wanted to hang with, even if they were, you know, door-to-door salesmen.
Yeah. Yeah, just good people. It's amazing that you've had such experiences with this. And then we have Clapton. Was this part of the contact sheet you were showing him?
No, this was after that.
Okay.
This was Eric in late 1974.
Uh-huh.
In fact, this particular day, he did two shows. And I remember he wasn't feeling well in between shows, so we got in a car and went to the beach and just walked around and came mm-hmm. back. And, you know, at that point in time, too, I mean, a lot of people thought Eric was God as mm-hmm. far as his playing.
Mm-hmm.
And he was and remains, you know, arguably one of the two, three, four best, not just blues guitarists, but guitarists.
Yeah.
I'd say Eric, Jeff Beck, Jimmy Page, Peter Green, Rory Gallagher, and I'm leaving, I'm sure.
I mean, it's ridiculous because the amount of photos that we're showing doesn't even give like a breadth of what you have done, and you probably can't even think of all the people that you've come across and photographed. That
I forgot that I shot Rick James when I found the thing. I went, Rick James? and I went, what? And I went, Oh, yeah.
And this is just a random find that I found of the Saturday Night Live cast. Where is this?
This was at Winterland. It was the last show they ever that Winterland ever, you know, hosted, because uh-huh. they tore it down. And it was New Year's Eve. The Blues Brothers opened up for the Grateful Dead.
Nice. Oh,
the
man.
Entire cast of Saturday Night Live came out. It was pandemonium backstage. It was great.
I bet.
I mean, great party. I mean, you see Lorraine, you see Bill Murray, Harold Ramis, and the Blues Brothers are playing.
Right.
And everybody's like, yeah.
Oh, that's so great. All right, so moving on. Got Sex Pistols here.
One of the two or three greatest shows I ever both shot or saw. And I was on assignment for Rolling Stone when they first called me up. I thought, the Sex Pistols. And their album had just come out in this country. A friend of mine had played it for me. Rolling Stone said, yeah, you're going to shoot the Stones at Winterland. I went, oh. I said, oh, you don't like him? I said, have you heard him? And the writer that had called me hadn't really heard him.
Mm-hmm.
He said, it's punk, right? I said, yeah. I said, these guys suck. I said, I can't play, and I can play better than them. And then I saw some 5-10 second feeds. I remember CBS said something, I think, when they played Atlanta. And then they played that bar, country western bar in, I think, Fort Worth.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard when they showed up, it was a half punk crowd, half redneck.
Mm-hmm.
And when they went on and started playing, the rednecks started, you know, yelling stuff and, you know, get off the stage, you fucking faggots, and started throwing bottles.
Oh, man.
Bottles, one of the bottles hit the stage and broke, and Sid picked one up and started, like, slashing himself.
Oh, my
started
God.
Bleeding, and then the rednecks got, like, real quiet. Like, man, who are these fucking guys? They came to San Francisco. They showed up for sound check. It was raining, and I'm, you know, at this point in time, I'm like, as they got off the bus, just the energy, you knew it was going to be something special.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Sid was the last one off, and he kind of stumbled in his leather jacket, and he's got a Nazi armband on his knee.
Oh, geez.
And I'm thinking, oh, because Bill Graham, at that point, the Sol Harak of promoters in rock and roll, both here and globally, he and his what was left of his family had walked across from Poland trying to escape the Nazis.
Uh-huh.
And he eventually was, you know, brought up, you know, an adopted family in the Bronx. When they came through the door, Bill grabbed Malcolm McLaren and goes, that's not a fashion statement. So that came off. I went home. I told Kristen, I said, hey, you've got to come with me. She goes, to see them? And I said, you know what? Just trust me. I don't know what's going to happen. This is going to be epic. We got there early. The lobby was jammed. It was all the punk scene had come up from L.A., mingling with the San Francisco punk scene. They'd never seen each other. When they came on, there was no pit. It was pandemonium. It was like a full riot. As they hit the stage, shoes, bottles were flying on the stage. People in the front were like hacking lungers up on the band.
Oh, gross.
And the band's playing, it's like a maelstrom, sweat dripping off the walls. I'm not a small guy, but I'm like shooting right from the front of the stage, and I'm being lifted off my feet, you know, mosh pit people, you know.
Uh-huh.
Bill Graham grabbed Kristen out of the crowd, pulled her up, you know, looked at me like, how could you have it down there with these animals? This picture here is the last number. As they finished, they're walking off the stage and stuff is still flying onto the stage. Johnny grabs the microphone and goes, don't you all feel cheated? And that was it. They were done, although nobody knew it at the time. We went backstage and it was still a lot of their friends in the punk scene here, some people from New York, some people from LA. And I remember the drummer for Stray Cats had showed up with his then girlfriend, Britt Eklund. Sid and this girl, Ivy, come from this backstage area. And Sid is obviously just fixed up.
Mm-hmm.
His eyes are watering. His nose is running. He's kind of like reeling. He sees Britt and Sonny Jim and kind of like goes back and forth and like projectile vomits.
Oh, God.
He gets to the bottom of her coat. She lets out a scream. And this guy next to me, this punk from L.A., goes, oh, that is so punk.
That is so punk. Well, I don't have the photo on here, but you have a story. Who was it that, oh man, I'm having a brain fart right now, but someone was on stage and he fell and like.
Oh, Jim Morrison.
Jim Morrison, that's right. Jim Morrison.
And that, you know what? That was the first show I ever shot, and I was working for Bobby Kennedy. It was in May of 68. I see this. There's a lineup. It's Steve Miller, Big Brother in the Holding Company, Grateful Dead, Jefferson Airplane, Country Joe and the Fish, The Doors, Ravi Shankar. And I thought, I've got to see this. I think it was $275 or $350 for the ticket. So I had a camera with two rolls of film. And I thought, I'm going to shoot a frame on each band, and then I'll save the last roll for The Doors.
Yeah.
Because at that time, Light My Fire, it was the biggest, you know. And I met Jim Marshall that day.
Yeah.
And we went backstage. Jim knew everybody. When The Doors went on, it was just, there was a light rain, almost a mist starting to fall, even though it's middle of May. But Jim, I thought, was stoned. He was probably stoned too, but it turned out he was drunk.
Mm-hmm.
And at one point he slipped and fell. I've got a picture of it.
Yep.
And stage is low. And so he kind of like leaned forward and put his hand on my shoulder. I thought, to right himself to stand up. put his hand on my shoulder, leans over my shoulder, and throws up on the people behind
me. Oh, my gosh.
I thought, wow.
this is for me. This is where I want to be in my life. That's amazing. And we'll talk more about your buddy here in a few. So now we have Tom Petty. And this was a portrait, obviously. So was this on assignment?
Yeah, I was on assignment for Rolling Stone. They were playing that night at Winterland. They were staying at the Miyako Hotel, which is fairly close by, and that's where most of the groups at that point in time would stay. There were these young guys. I brought a little portfolio to show them, just sort of like, hey, I've done this before, guys. And I remember they were going through it, and Tom goes, wow, I sure hope we're in this someday. And I said, hey, this is for Rolling Stone. You guys, their first album was out. I said, you guys are already on your way.
Yeah.
And there was no, you know, they said, here, you want to do it here in the room? And it was dark, and I thought, no. I said, let's go out on the balcony. And the balcony is about
one of those tiny ones.
Yeah. And it was like, here, I'll Vaseline my arms, and we'll. But it worked out. It was perfect.
That's awesome. That's a great shot. And then Blondie, this was at the was it the Botanical Garden that you went to, or
it was the Arboretum, the Hall of Flowers in Golden Gate Park, and it looks like something out of the, you know, the Pan Pacific Exhibition. They had just gotten back from Japan, and I really didn't know the band, and I kind of met them in the lobby, and they had a car, so we jumped in the car, went to the park, I shot them. And, you know, on a lot of these shoots, I'd have kind of a rough idea of what I would like to do. But I'd always talk to the band, too. You know, I'd say, here, I'm thinking about doing this and this. But, you know, what do you think? You know, how do you want to be portrayed?
Mm-hmm.
And often they had no idea. No, we just want it to be like, you know, make us look good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah.
There was very little direction. I shot a number of things. This particular shot, I've got the band in focus and Debbie a little out of focus. I've got another shot where Debbie is, you know, in profile, looking beautiful as she always did and does, and the band a little out of focus. But the lighting in there, it was muted lighting. I was using Kodachrome film. It all worked out. It was beautiful.
That's awesome. And then we have, this is Chris Isaac, right? Yeah. This is a beautiful shot, too. I mean, was it... When you were with him, was this also a portrait shoot, or were you just out hanging?
We were out hanging. We had a week here in New York, and it was Chris was really breaking out across the country because his song Wicked Game had been in the David Lynch movie, and it really propelled them into, I don't want to say stardom. Mm-hmm. We had a week's residency at Danceteria, so we went around New York shooting pictures for an afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, I met at the Art Institute. They were playing when his band Silvertone was first starting out. And when I saw them, I thought, God, this is like the fucking Sun studio session, both in terms of the sound and that rockabilly and Chris's kind of projection and demeanor. It turned out he loved Elvis.
Mm-hmm.
And it also turned out he was raised in Stockton, California, about half a mile from where I used to live, you know, albeit we were like 25 years apart.
Mm-hmm.
And he lived in this little, literally a garage that you have to turn sideways to get in because it was his clothes, a bed, and all his record albums. So he started hanging out at our house, and he'd babysit our son Ari, raid the refrigerator. And
incredible story. It's just insane. Okay, so we've got some pretty famous photos here from The Who, and this is the sort of famous drummer.
Yeah, Scott Halpin. That night, that was the first night of their 1973 tour, the Fallout Shelter tour, and Moon had taken, as it turned out, somebody said acid, but it was somebody said gorilla tranquilizer in LA with some girl he met, missed the plane up, missed sound check. And I guess, and again, this is an as told to, when he arrived with the girl, they took her right to the hospital. He goes to the gig. We had played about four or five numbers, and then the band stopped playing, and he had fallen out. Now, I didn't know that at the time. I just thought, well, you know, what happened? And so now we leave the stage, and I remember they went backstage. Peter Rudge is talking to Bill Graham, and Bill's pissed.
We've got 11,000 people.
No, Bill, don't worry. It's going to be all right. And so I go in to get some more film. I'm thinking I'll get a few more rolls of film before we go back on. I didn't know what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
Moon is curled up kind of under this the table where they had the food. And Townsend's is kind of like, ah. And Townsend's going, Keith, you all right? And he like grabs the sandwich. He says, have a corned beef sandwich.
Oh, God.
And so we end up going back on the stage, played two numbers maybe. And at one point, I had taken a couple pictures, and Mooney is just pouring sweat. He kind of looked like that painting of Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane. And all of a sudden, just kind of fell back into the roadie's arms. The show stops. Pete goes to the microphone, and he says, listen, our drummer's a bit ill tonight. We'd like to continue playing for you. Is there a drummer in the house? And that night, there were probably five or six. I know Mike Shreve of Santana was there. I think Spencer Dryden of the Airplane. There were a bunch of drummers. This guy comes out of the audience. They huddle up. He ends up playing the rest of the show. Sounded okay to me. Turned out Scott Halpin was a 17-year-old junior at Carmel Valley High School.
Oh, my gosh.
Had never played in a band in his life. But the story was he used to go home after school. He had a drum kit in his room. He'd smoke a joint, put the headphones on, and then he'd be Led Zeppelin or
right.
And I heard that when he went back to school that Monday and told his friends that he played with the Who.
You're a liar.
You played with the Who, uh-huh. Sure, man.
Sure. And then this is actually a photo of you backstage, which is just insane. That's Jerry Garcia. I mean, like, by the way, do we know who took this photo?
Snooky Flowers took this photo. He was Janice's sax player at the time and a session musician. And I actually got this photo from Bill Kreutzmann's son, who's a documentarian, does videos, does all kinds of things. But Snooky was there, and I'd gone with Townsend from the Who's dressing room in to see Jerry. And you've got Pete here. You've got Deborah Coons, who is at that point in time Jerry's girlfriend, later married him. You've got Jerry. You've got Robert Hunter that wrote a lot of the Dead's and New Writers stuff with and for Jerry. Mm-hmm. You've got Phil Lesh. You've got John McIntyre, who is the Dead's manager.
Mm-hmm.
Then you've got me trying to be invisible.
Incredible. When I actually got to go to a Dead show, and I was, I believe, 9 years old at Buckeye Lake.
Wow.
Because my ex-stepfather was a big Deadhead, and he brought me and my stepsister, and we went off to go get pizza at one point, the two of us, and someone, and I remember this now, it's really funny looking back, but someone was, you know, someone was rolling joints and stuff and all their weeds out, and I actually stopped. My sister and I were 9 and 10 years old or something, and I walked by and I said, excuse me, is that oregano? And she goes, yes, dear. Yes, it is. But this is just incredible to me. Yeah, I mean, these special moments backstage that, you know, most people don't get to see. You know, you think of the actual concert itself and how amazing it was, but you have these quiet moments, and this is Townsend, right?
Yes, Pete's just got kind of tuning his guitar before they go on.
Yeah, awesome. And then, oh, here he is again.
Now he's ready to go. Let's do the show.
Yep, let's do it to it. Wow. This is a famous shot here.
I took it, but I really give all credit to Kristen, because what happened before, this is at Winterland. These were the last two shows that the Who ever played at Winterland, you know, shortly before Winterland closed, late March of 76. I'm on my knees in the dressing room, taking film out of canisters, loading the cameras. Moon comes in and goes, I've got a surprise for you. And I said, for me? And he pulls out this plastic bag and holds it up. And I said, what is that, jerky? And he goes, jerky? Opens the bag, pulls out this like withered black thing. He says, it's magic mushroom, isn't it? And I went, wow. So he tears it in half, eats half of it, washes it down. He says, you fancy some? I said, I don't know, man. I've got to shoot. And he goes, and I've got to play me fucking drums. So I went, okay. Bitter as hell, washed it down, and now we're starting to go up on stage, and I pulled his back of his shirt, and I said, Mooney, what kind of trip's this going to be? And he goes, don't know. And so I went through maybe three quarters of the show, and they had these two little stands about 10 feet off the stage in the audience here, and Kristen and I are shooting from one, and at one point she hands me one of the cameras, but there's kind of like a trail, and now I'm starting to kind of come on, and I'm feeling kind of weird. And now I'm getting a little more anxious and kind of like feeling hot and flush. And I said, hey, you know what? She said, are you all right? And I said, let's go up on the stage and we'll finish up there. So now we're on the side of the stage and I'm shooting, but now I'm starting to get really claustrophobic and I'm feeling like, you know, hey, if we're in an elevator, I want to get off on this floor.
Right.
This is
right,
as
right.
high as I want to go.
Right, right, right.
And I said, hey, let's go up in the balcony, because they had the back balcony there closed mm-hmm. off. So we went up the stairs, and we're standing there right at the front row, and I'm tripping. And I'm kind of like, wow. And she goes, hey, are you shooting this? And I went, oh, yeah. And I took this picture, and this is right at the end of the show. Pete's, you see everybody in the place is on their feet. They're roaring. Their hands are up. Pete throws the guitar up. I take three or four pictures. Moon stands up on his seat, and I'd forgotten, you know, like we both did this, and all of a sudden crashes into the through the drum kit into the cymbals, falling onto his back. Townsend grabs one ankle, John Entwistle the other. They drag him off the stage. End of show.
Oh my gosh. What a story. Insane, insane. And then this is amazing too. It got, you're like on stage with Dylan. Like,
I don't know what to say. I mean, this day, Humble Pie had been in town. I'd shot them the night before. We live in the Hate. This is Kezar Stadium when the 49ers used to play. It's like four blocks from the house. Ring on the doorbell. It's Bob Mayo, Peter's keyboard player. He goes, hey, are you going to the snack benefit? And mm-hmm. this was Bill Graham had put it on to raise money for the San Francisco schools. And I said, you know, I hadn't thought about it, but he said, well, do you think you can get me in? And I said, oh, okay. I said, let me try. So he and Kristen and I got a camera. We just walk over, and I knew next to Kezar was Kezar Pavilion. USF used to play basketball there, mm-hmm. and that's where the 49ers dressing room was. And you go through the pavilion, and there's a long underground tunnel, and it comes out. That's where the 49ers would come out into the field. There's nobody there. We walk through. We walk out. Well, that's backstage. And all these people are there, and so we're talking. And then somebody said, oh, you know, Bob Dylan's going to be here. And this is 75.
Right.
Dylan had done his first live thing since his motorcycle accident the previous year when he'd gone out with the band. Mm-hmm. So that was kind of a big deal. But so we're just mingling with our buddies back. Remember, the airplane was there. I see Jerry Garcia. I run into John Brody, the 49er quarterback. He's there with his wife, Cedric Hardman. And all of a sudden, I see Dylan, and I see a couple of people that are going up on stage, and Bill Graham's standing at the stop, and he goes, Michael. And the guard tries to stop us. He goes, no, Kristen. So we come up on stage, and fairly small stage. We're all around, so I start shooting, and then I see somebody like kind of push me. It's Francis Coppola, and he's got Marlon Brando with him.
Oh my God!
And Neil Young, and it's one of those things where you're just like, oh shit! but you always act like, hey, this is pretty much like my living room every night.
Yeah, exactly.
And so just shot. I remember Brando came and gave a little talk. I've got one proof sheet, and it's in the book. We're on one roll of film. You've got Dylan. You've got Rick Danko, you've got Neil Young, you've got Marlon Brando, Frank Werber, you've got Patricia Pavanetti, who is kind of Francis's girl Friday, Joan Baez, Sarah Dillon. Nobody ever sees Sarah Dillon.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just like kind of a magic moment, or as they say in baseball, a check swing home run.
Hey, I'd say. Next, we've got Rod Stewart back in the day. What a beautiful shot that is.
Yeah, you know what? They were always, I loved shooting the faces because they had so much fun. They were like guys that you might have gone to school with in the fraternity that got fucked up every night. I remember at this point in time, they loved to drink Matus and take mandrakes, which was like a mandrake's like a double quaalude, mate. You fucking feel great. And they'd come out and they'd be sloppy and kind of out of tune, but it sounded great. It meshed together, and with the energy they had, it was like this raucous party and a great time.
Incredible.
And the girls loved them.
Incredible, incredible. We got George Harrison. Do you have some background with George at all, or is this
you know
just
what a- I was? I mean, I was always a big Beatle fan and wanted, you know, like I think anybody at the time wanted to be with the Beatles, but I was just, you know, I was at the end of my high school thing and just going into college. And when I took this, the Beatles had broken up, and this was George's first tour. And he didn't play that well, and his voice kind of sounded like my voice.
Mm-hmm.
The whole tour, his voice was kind of gone. But it was great because it's 1973, and you're kind of with somebody that you think is part of the zeitgeist. It's funny, at one point he was saying how, you know, when did you realize that you guys were really changing the world? And he said, well, he says, at one point we're like in this shithole in Hamburg, like playing like 4 gigs a night. And he says, I get deported because I'm underage. And he says, we go back, we're working on the second album. And he says, all of a sudden, he says, birds are chasing us, going potty. And people are saying we're like bigger than Jesus. And we look at each other and like, we're the same blokes.
Yeah.
And like they're caught in the middle. And I think that happens a lot to, kind of like Trump, when you saw him with Obama, where he's thinking, you know, I'm fucking president.
Yeah.
How did this happen?
Yep.
Oh, now what?
Now what? That was something I was going to mention and talk about here at the end. And actually, this next one is the last music photo that we're going to show here today of Jimmy Page.
This is Jimmy. This was actually the last time Led Zeppelin played in the United States as Led Zeppelin. It was late July 1977. The irony here, too, the last time the Beatles ever played a live show as the Beatles was in Candlestick Park in San Francisco. The last time Sex Pistols ever played a show was at Winterland in San Francisco. So I guess there's something about the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
And this was an infamous show because the day before, Peter Grant, John Bonham, and Bindon, one of the roadies for Zeppelin, had beaten up severely one of Bill Graham's security guys.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was a chance that show wasn't going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Bill was livid. Peter Grant made him sign a paper saying they weren't responsible and he wouldn't sue. Bill Graham's lawyer at the time was William Koblenz, who was the head of Board of Regents, University of California, one of the most powerful people in the state. He told Bill, sign it. It has no validity because you're signing it under duress. And I'm shooting for Led Zeppelin, these two shows. So we get to the gig. Peter Barsotti, Bill's stage manager, goes, hey, Michael, that pass you have, he said, you can't, it's no good. I said, what? I said, this is the band. I'm working for Led Zeppelin. This is their laminate. He goes, yeah, Peter Grant's going to have to request one of our stage passes. I said, Peter, come on. I said, don't put me in the middle of this shit. He said, no, you have to ask him. So I go to Peter Grant, and Peter Grant, talk about infamous, this imposing figure who at one point had served jail time. And I remember saying to Bindon, I said, so I hear Peter did some time. He goes, did some time? I said, well, was in jail or prison? He goes, right, what about it? I said, well, I don't care. What happened? He says, what happened? He says, well, he was in for manslaughter, wasn't he? I said, manslaughter? He says, right, man. Manslaughter. It's what happens when you, like, kill some bloke, but you've got fucking bread.
Oh, God.
And I went, okay. Oy. So I have to go
to this guy.
To Peter.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, I said, Peter, listen. He says, do I have a problem? I said, you know, I don't. But I said, Bill Graham's stage manager, Peter Barsotti, said, I can't go on stage with this pass. You have to request one of their passes.
Mm-hmm.
He says,
you tell Peter Barsotti you've got the only fucking pass you need, and you're working for Led Zeppelin. And I said, but and you tell him, if anyone lays a hand on you, he says, we've got two blokes packing, and we'll blow them away.
Oh my God.
I said, Peter, I can't. He says, no, man. He says, you tell him straight away. So I go back. I tell Barsotti. He goes, wait a minute. He said, he'll blow us away. I said, Peter, he's really upset. It's figure of speech. He goes, hold on. He comes back with Bill. Bill goes, Michael, what did Peter Grant say? I said, Bill, he's really upset. I said, you know, he's not going to request a pass. He says, no, I want you to tell me what he said word for word.
Uh-huh.
So I tell him again. He goes, he'll blow us away? And I said, Bill, no, no, come with me. And I'm thinking, fuck, I'm done. I'm not going to be able to shoot. And I've got a baby, you know, like, and I want to. So he takes me down to the front of the stage, and there are about 10 or 12 guys. A couple guys had cutoffs with their ankles and their hands taped. Simone guy, and Bill goes, see this man? He says, holds up my laminate. He's working for Led Zeppelin, but he's a friend of ours. Remember his face. If there's any problems, no one lay a hand on him. He says, you can go now. Shot the whole show. At the end of the show, there's like 12 Alameda County Sheriffs, Highway Patrol, Oakland PD, escort the band to the airport where they have surrounded Led Zeppelin's plane. They take Peter, John Bonham, Bindon, arrest him with assault. They spend the night in Alameda County Jail. Band flies on to New Orleans, where they were going to play, I think, the Superdome in 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
They wake up the next day. Robert Plant finds out his son, Carrick, beautiful four-year-old child, long hair, kind of looked like the kid on that Swan Song logo. He had contracted peritonitis and died.
Oh, my gosh.
They fly back to England. After that, I heard they played Nebworth Fair. They played a couple gigs in the north of England, a couple in Germany, and then Bonham died.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it. You can tell that day, Jimmy, who was kind of out of it, but came on and started playing, and it was fucking diabolical. It was unbelievable. It was like he was channeling something from another galaxy. And I always loved Zeppelin because I thought, of all the bands, they were truly metaphysical and, you know, not just seeped in Celtic myth, but they were magic.
Yeah.
And they were special.
Yeah. Wow. What an incredible story to end the music portion on. I have a few more photos that I wanted, just because this all sort of takes place that we looked at just now, like in the 70s and
yeah,
prior.
It was a 10-12 year period.
Yeah. And so, I just want to also, so we talked about it briefly at the beginning, but you transitioned into a sports photographer, a full-time sports photographer, right, working for the 49ers and the A's. And I'm curious, did it have anything to do with how many concerts you shot in these stadiums, your connection to this all? Or
I'd played ball. I mean, I'd played ball in college. I mean, I wanted as a kid, I think like a lot of us, I wanted to be Roberto Clemente. I wanted to be Mickey Mantle. I wanted to be Stan Musial. I wanted to be Johnny Unitas. I wanted to do all that.
Right.
I was actually, I started with the Niners in 73, and I was doing rock and roll at the same time. And these were kind of different roads to the same place. The players, like the musicians, were all pretty much within 10 years the same age.
Mm-hmm.
And they were going through the same stuff on the same planet.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the ball players wanted to be them, you know, their fantasy,
right,
was, you know, if I could be Mick Jagger, if I could be,
sure,
Jim Morrison.
Sure.
And a lot of the musicians wished they were ball players.
Yeah.
Rod Stewart always wanted to be a soccer star. Ken Stabler, he loved Ronnie Van Zant. Check this out. Ronnie used to always carry a football card of the Snake in his wallet. And sometimes he'd get fucked up. He'd be running down the hall at 3 a.m, and he'd pull up in front of you and cock his arm and goes, I'm the fucking Snake. And so 1987, 10 years after the plane crashes, Stabler had just retired and was doing color, I think, for CBS. The Niners are opening the season in Pittsburgh. The day before the game, you have a walkthrough.
Uh-huh.
Stabler comes up to me and he goes, Z, somebody said you toured with Skynyrd? I said, yeah. He said, you never told me that. I said, no, I thought you knew that, man. He said, man, I fucking loved Ronnie. I said, no, man, he loved you too. I said, how did you guys meet? And he said, meet? He said, I never met him. I said, what? I said, he carried your card. I said, you were all he talked about sometimes. I said, you were his fucking idol.
Incredible.
I said, he wanted to be you.
I think I've got a picture
of him. And Kenny looked up and kind of got tears in his eyes, and he said, shit. He said, he was my idol, man. I wanted to be him. He said, man, you should have hooked us up. And I said, you know, I didn't know, but I said, fuck, if I would have hooked us up, we'd probably all be dead.
Oh, no. Oh, no. And some of these photos we're running past, I mean, this is O.J. Simpson.
Yeah.
And this is his last.
That was in Atlanta. O.J. had just finished his last game. He's holding the ball, walking down the tunnel alone into retirement and what he didn't know at the time, infamy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I love this picture. I mean, it was really moody. And
Oh, yeah. And then, of course, infamous photo of Madden. And then, let's see here. And you were back, not backstage, but behind the scenes with all of these
and
teams.
And you know what? Very few photographers at that time, or even now, were ever granted any kind of access at all. When Bill came to the 49ers, he had been there about a week. You know, I went and talked to him. And I told him I wanted to shoot the team as I shot rock and roll as a photojournalist. And I said, I thought it was important because I think you're going to bring something really special here. And I want to document this as history as opposed to just sports. And I want to be, you know, just embed myself and capture football from the point of view of the player. And I said, because I actually played a short time for Bill. You know, when I was started law school, I was done with college,
mm-hmm.
wasn't drafted, had like a quick tryout for the Colts, that didn't happen. And I see an article in the paper, San Jose Apaches tryouts.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like a semi-pro team. Well, I show up thinking it was really like Sandlot shit. They were in fact kind of a farm team for the Raiders. They had Raider uniforms. Bill's the head coach.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I lasted there for about a week and a half, and I reminded him of that, and he hated the Apache. He didn't want, you know, like...
Right.
And so he said, look, I like your idea because above and beyond being a coach, he was a historian, a student of history, a man of letters, and he was really into documenting it. He says, well, what happens if you go too far? I said, you know what, coach, honestly, I might push the envelope. I said, all you have to do is just
look at me,
and I'll back off.
Yeah.
And that did happen a couple
sure.
times. But you know what? I was very fortunate that he was there, an extraordinary man, gave me extraordinary access,
mm-hmm.
and the rest is history.
The rest is history. And this is, you know, one of your... I'd say most famous sports photos. Yeah, would you say?
Yeah, I mean, and again, that was late in the championship game with the Bears in January of '85, and I was on the bench, and they had a little sideline meeting with a timeout, like they often did, and so I came out. You know, you try to be unobtrusive, so I remember I got kind of down on a knee, and then I just started like crawling, and shot up with the sky and. You know, when you take something, you don't go, oh, it's a fucking great shot.
Mm-hmm.
You shoot, and, you know, after the fact, you start mm-hmm. seeing, like, wow, this is...
Was this shot black and white?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, see, in those days, there was no digital. This is all film.
Right.
So I'd have some bodies with black and white, some in color.
And that was another thing that maybe we can talk about, because this is going to be sort of showing a transition here in a minute from black and white to color.
Sure.
And I'm curious, you know, what that was like, A, for you... going from black and white to color, or, you know, were you?
I shot more color as I got into it into the 80s, but I always, the first 10 years, shot everything backstage or in the locker room as black and white because it felt that way. I mean, some things are just black and white. The Hustler on the waterfront,
mm-hmm.
they have that feel, you know, almost like a tabloid thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it just worked.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And then going through here in a second, it changed. Here we go. Now we kind of change over to color. And were you shooting chrome?
Yeah. I mean, well, I started out shooting
Kodachrome 64, and then they, I think it was 200, and then I started shooting. I liked Fujichrome for sports because it really, I mean, some guys would say it's not true color. It wasn't. It was enhanced. This is like when I shot fashion, I used to like to shoot Agfa and then push it.
Oops. You're sideways here. Whoops. Well, anyways,
we'll just lay down.
But anyways, this kind of gives you an idea. That one that's sideways, I kind of want to, I'm going to go ahead and pull it out of here real quick because I do want to show it because it actually shows you in kind of the, what you do. You put on the cleats, you know, you go and you get taped up with the players. So you become a part of the team.
That's the whole thing. You know, it's all, again, it's all Stanislavski. You know, you to me, and some people, I mean, I'm sure there's some photographers and people go, that's bullshit. Mm-hmm. I mean, some guys, their approach is, no, you've got to be detached. And I guess they do. I don't. The whole reason I always did this anyway, whatever it was, it was as much to me about the experience as it was about documenting what I was shooting. And it's like, if you're an actor, or if you're doing this, you know, if I did any of this all the time, whether it was shooting rock and roll or being rock and roll or being a sports guy, I'd get bored. I get bored. I need to change things up. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, this is great. Now what?
Mm-hmm. And also, by the way, those photos of you were by Brad Manchin. Thank you to Brad Manchin for sending along some of these fun pics.
You know what? If Brad disappeared, I'd be lost. I mean, above and beyond him being one of my best friends and a great guy.
Right.
And himself a great shooter.
Yeah.
I mean, he's done things like that. He facilitates getting my pictures to people. I mean, he does things where...
Well, he did today. I mean, it's and that was another thing, talking about sort of the going from black and white to color, and then from I guess in 2003 was sort of when you went from film to digital, right? And I imagine it might have been a bit difficult of a transition for you at that point. I mean, I
hated it at first. Any change is, I think, hard for most people, but it would be like you're telling me, hey, you know, you've got to shoot the horse, you've got to use this car.
Yeah.
And I'd be, hell no, I'm never going to get rid of my horse.
Yeah.
And at some point they're going, sorry, buddy, you can't go to Indy with a horse.
Right.
You've got to get a car.
And then you also, so you're the team photographer for these guys, and this kind of shows how you really do stay, you try, it seems like you place yourself in positions that, you know, the regular press cannot get to, and you utilize your position for the access that it gives you.
Right. And you know what? More and more, it's harder to do anything, even with me, because of this control and corporate stuff. And I don't care about that. I want to get the best place for the picture.
Sure.
You know, there's a famous Life magazine cover that was a fold out, and it was a kickoff at Memorial Stadium in Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
And the camera was on the ground right by where the ball was. You could see the whole stadium, the kicker coming forward.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember going to Bill and I said, I want, you know, this is what I want to do. And he's going, I don't know. He said, what? You can't be out there for the kickoff. I said, no. I get the camera on a remote. But I said, as soon as he kicks it, I run full speed. And he goes, well, what happens if you get tangled up? And I said, Bill, come on. I played for you. I've got good speed. I'm not going to get tangled up with anybody. And I don't care what the rules are. I just want to make the picture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I've always tried to do.
Mm-hmm.
And more, it's, you know who gets those pictures a lot? TV, because they have
the money. Yeah. The rights and all that ridiculousness. So, and then we got, I think that we sort of end your sports work. There's so much more that you guys can, that people can find online of your sports work and, of course, your music work. This wasn't the last photo. I wanted to come back to Jim Marshall, because you mentioned meeting him. I guess when did you meet him? You have an amazing story.
May 18th, 1968, the day that I, you know, talked myself into the pit at the Santa Clara Folk Rock Music Festival.
And so Jim Marshall, just for people that don't know, is also a legendary rock photographer. It's like, you know.
Oh, yeah.
It's like one of the only people that can top you. You know what I mean? Like,
well, you know, it's funny. I'm trying to act like I belong, and I'm shooting, and there actually weren't many people that were really professional shooting at all. There were a lot of fraternity people. And there was this guy giving Jim, who at the time had a corduroy coat, about six or seven cameras hanging around him in this hat. And all of a sudden, he pulls out a knife and puts it to this guy's throat. And the fraternity guy just almost shits his pants. And I said, "Hey, man, is that a real knife?" And he turned to me and he puts the knife on my neck. He goes, "Yeah, it's a real knife." And he reaches behind and pulls a gun out of the back of his waistband. And he said, "And this is real too, motherfucker." And I said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Jim Marshall. Who the fuck are you?" We introduced ourselves, became friends ever since. So come with me. He took me backstage. I mean, he turned out he was Armenian, but as he said, he was a Syrian. And I said, "Well, if my people are from Crete, but if you're a Syrian, I guess I'm Minoan." And he goes, "I'll tell you something." He said, "My people were eating off gold plates when your fucking people were like rubbing sticks together trying to make fire." And Jim was probably a bigger character than any of the people he shot.
Yeah.
An incredible photographer at an incredible point in time.
I'm bummed I never got to meet him.
Yeah, he's I brought Brad one day over, and Brad
Brad's told me all the stories about him. I that's how I know about him for the most part. And then this photo shoot real quickly was tell me about this photo shoot real quick.
A friend of ours that just recently passed away, right. Tim Mantuani, had this project where he wanted to do 20 by 24 Polaroid shots of most of the living photographers of note, with each photographer holding up what they thought at that point in time was their most iconic image. And I didn't realize at the time that was Tim's, we were his first two subjects.
Oh, wow.
And he knew I knew Jim, so I brought Jim in, and we shot. It turned out Tim came out with a book, and he had some, I mean, he had almost everyone alive. There are a few people he missed or wouldn't do it, Annie Leibovitz being one of them.
Right.
There are a couple others. But he, an amazing, amazing project. And Tim was an amazing guy.
Yeah. Yeah. And he, this was just recent that he passed. Yeah, it was pretty
recent.
He
passed about a month ago.
Yeah.
He had contracted cancer about 12 years ago, like a good friend of ours, Vijay Lavero.
Vijay, yeah, yeah.
And, I mean, it's amazing because those guys were as clean cut as you could be.
Yeah.
Didn't smoke, you know, rarely
drank. Cancer's a
real
bitch. Yeah.
Yeah. And I remember telling Tim at one point, I said, "You know, that's what happens when you live too clean a life." I said, "It can sneak up on you." I said, "I think with me, all the shit I did, maybe all of those bad things like just fled my body."
Yeah.
But I'm kidding.
Yeah.
Jeez
Louise. And then, you know, I think we're going to end it on this wonderful
wow.
shot of you. Can you tell me when? I mean, this is with Jim Brown, obviously, but.
This is, I think, 63 or 64. At that point, I was still in high school and I was making my own passes to get on the field at a time when you could still do that.
Just laminating some cardboard or something?
No, it was just like little pieces of art paper, and every week they would change the color of the paper, but it would always have the old prospector on the football. So I'd draw that on there and had a little, you know, string, and I'd see what the photographers were wearing. And there weren't many, by the way.
Right, right, right.
There were like 10, 12 guys. And I'd take out that color close to it, put it on my thing. The first time I did it, and in those days, the field security was every 10 yards at Kyzar Stadium, that had SFPD. So I had a hat that I had put a little card that said press. I mean, almost anything. Like, it's like, "That guy, get him out of here."
Yeah.
So, and I came onto the field with an Ansco camera, and one of the cops started walking right toward me. Like, so I walked right toward him, and I saw on his little tag it said Pope. So I said, "Officer Pope, Michael Zagaris." I said, "I'm shooting a book called Sunday Gladiators for the NFL, but no book would really be complete about the league without the denizens of the Guardians of the Field. Would you mind getting a few of the officers? I'd like to get a shot of you guys in front of the bench." So he goes, "Yeah." So he got about six guys together. I took a picture. They never fucked with me again.
Oh, my gosh. That's amazing.
And then
that's great.
We'd go out and pose players before the game like a football card.
And I remember when the Packers came to town, Lombardi was in the middle of the field. And so I walked out in the middle of the field, and I said, Coach Lombardi? He's like, yeah. And I said, same spiel. Sunday Gladiators, I'm doing a book. He goes, yeah. I said, mind if I get a couple of pictures? He says, go away. And I said, what? He said, just take it. So I took one picture, and I said, Coach, could you kind of like roll that program up and maybe point looking up into the future? He goes, what? He says, I'm trying to get ready for a ball game. Get the fuck out of here. So I go back to the sideline, and my friend said, wow, you know Lombardi? I said, hell yeah, we're old friends.
Oh, my gosh, that's hilarious. Well, that's it, Michael. I actually got through. Oh, I guess the only thing I didn't mention was, you know, a week ago, Mr. Trump was elected, and I had that. I know we talked about it briefly. You know, you were talking about anybody can be president, it seems. You could have made that
well,
happen.
Well, you know what? This has been pretty light. But this now what I'm going to say is really serious.
Mm-hmm.
I loathe him
mm-hmm.
and everything he represents and stands for. But I understand why a number of people voted for him and what they think he can do for them and bring them. As distressing as this is, he's merely symptomatic of something much darker and wrong with both our country and our people and the world in general. Because when you have someone like that resonating with people, we're not split right down the middle as a country.
Mm-hmm.
We're fragmented, kind of like Iraq and Syria. And what's going on here is going on globally. And you've got all these people, refugees globally, moving. When you've got the rise of totalitarian governments with people like him espousing the same demagogic bullshit, when you've got a lot of people lost that want someone saying what they're saying and blaming other people to fix it, we're in really dark times. And you know what? I don't know what this means, but I don't think it's going to be good for any of us. Now, that being said, I've always wanted to be right in the middle of anything, including the apocalypse.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? I get to be. This is kind of like, this is like the IMAX movie of the apocalypse that we're not only watching, we're in. And if we don't like it, too bad. They've locked the door to the theaters. We're in this.
We're in it together.
Yeah.
Well, on that note, I think that we're going to end it. I just want to, again, point out that y'all should go and pick up Z's amazing book. You can order it online. I know that Milk Gallery has a signed copies that they're selling online. You can see the exhibit again until...
Milk is amazing.
Yeah.
It's an amazing place, with or without my work.
Yep.
Just for the things they do, the people... Not only work there, but all the things that happen there, both in terms of art, in terms of fashion, the eclectic group of people, the
mm-hmm.
young people. And, you know, my publisher that took a chance on this book at a time when if you're a publisher, that's a high wire act.
Yeah.
My designer, Dagan James, to me, this is our book, not just my book.
Yeah, did an amazing job.
I mean, Dagan is a wizard. You know, long after I'm gone, people should be knocking down his door
to get
him to do things.
Thanks again to Adorama, those of you that came and joined us in person, those of you that are all watching online on Facebook, thank you. Tune in again. Thank you to Canon Professional Services, Temba Bags, and most importantly to you, Z-Man, for making your way over.
Oh, Robert,
this
is great.
It was such a pleasure,
and I
hope we can hang out again someday.
Definitely.
All right.
No.
We'll see you all again next time. Cheers.
Later.